good introduction planned, all about stories and things, but Rabbi Jay is in a hurry. So let's just say a prayer. It's a Jewish tradition that every generation is responsible for healing the world, for bringing peace and community and harmony, and making a prayer. And I wanted to share a prayer in terms of healing the world. Tikkun, tikkun.
Tikkun olam.
Tikkun olam. Peace to you, ministering angels, messengers of the Most High, from the King of Kings, the Holy One, blessed be He. Enter in peace, angels of peace, messengers of the Most High, from the King of Kings, the Holy One, blessed be He. Bless me with peace, angels of peace, messengers of the Most High, from the King of Kings, the Holy One, blessed be He. Depart in peace, angels of peace, messengers of the Most High, from the King of Kings, the Holy One, blessed be He. And if we stay around a few minutes after Rabbi Jay finishes, I will let you know a little bit more about why I picked the prayer for peace. INCO has been stressing and choosing our talks and our presentations all around peace this year.
That was perfect. Hi, Cal. So, that was some of the last, I don't know, Jews, there's a few Jews in the room. I never heard in English before. So that was really nice. Thank you, Cal. It's some of the last, we sing it every Friday night. So, it's beautiful to hear it in English. So I want to thank INCO, and I want to also thank Gail for inviting me to come, and I want to thank Jim for his help with the audiovisual situation. Thank you, Jim, upstairs. And originally, when Gail asked me to come on, there's room up front. When Gail asked me to come, you know, there was, I understood in the old days, because I used to come to INCO things a lot, and I had about 20 minutes to do, you know, that was what I understood. And I said, oh, sure, I'll do that, no problem. And then I came to the presentation by the Mormon Church, and I realized, it's a whole different format now, so I have an hour and a half to do. So a whole different shift, as we say. So what I brought you today is little pieces of a class that I teach. I teach an 8-week class, 12 hours of class. I brought you some images from that. I brought you concepts, sort of the bigger kinds of concepts within Judaism that I've identified. Certain central themes within Judaism. I brought you parts of our service that we do Friday nights and Saturday mornings. And I'm trying to impart to you really a flavor of what Judaism is and how we practice it here in Central Oregon, which is not the way it's practiced everywhere in the world. We have our own special niche. So what I'm doing essentially is I'm squeezing 4,000 years into an hour and a half, which of course cannot be done, but we're going to do the best that we can with them. So I want to start. Is it a little loud, or it feels loud to me? Is it loud to you? No. I can just adjust that down. So hi, Florence. Hi. Welcome here. Hi. Glad to see you. So I want to start with the Nigun. The first concept I'm going to teach you is the Nigun. A Nigun is a melody without any words. This comes from the Eastern European tradition of the Hasidim. This goes back to the 1700s or earlier. And I love a nigun because, first of all, you can't get the words wrong because there aren't any. That's the first thing. And the second thing is everybody's on the same page. You know, everybody's on this. It's a level playing field for everyone. So let me sing it first, and I know there's people in the room that know it, but don't sing it yet. Just let me sing it once, and then when we go through it, and we'll do it two or three times as a group. And my expectation is that everybody sings. I like to sing, and I want everybody to sing. Okay? It's really simple. Ay, 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 ay,
ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay, ay,
exhausted. Hours on a Friday. I mean, hours. You know, I was in Tzfat, I was in Safed in English, it's called Tzfat in Hebrew. And we were doing the good and like that and going marching around in a circle in this one synagogue. And we were praying so hard and singing so from our souls and from our hearts. And I was exhausted and way overheated, and I went outside to cool off. And I literally looked up and down the street expecting to see the Messiah. I was disappointed. I was physically disappointed that the Mashiach didn't come, that the Messiah didn't come at that moment. Doesn't happen very often. So get comfortable in your chairs. We'll do a little meditation like we do on Friday nights. And I know some of you, I think there was a little, maybe a miscommunication about this having to do with the Holocaust. There is a Holocaust piece to this presentation, but it's towards the end and it's not a major part of the presentation. This is in the theme that INCO has had of basically bringing a religious experience and bringing education to its community. So get comfortable in your chairs, put your feet flat on the floor if you can reach, if you're willing to do it. And just relax, feel your body relaxing completely. And just allow yourself to be fully present. Close your eyes if you're willing to do it. And allow yourself to feel safe. Just allow a feeling of safety to overcome you. And feel yourself be at peace. And feel how good that feels to be at peace. And shift your focus now to gratitude. And begin to experience gratitude. Think about the things in your life that you're grateful for. Imagine for a moment that you're floating in a pool of gratitude. You're immersed physically in gratitude. And take a deep breath and keep your eyes closed. Just feel your body relaxing even further. And take a moment to review the week, the past week or so. And some things you got done, and some things perhaps you did not get done. And take a moment to forgive yourself. Say to yourself, Salachti, I forgive. Salachti, I forgive. Like God says to Moses, Salachti kitorecha, I have forgiven you according to your word. And then take another moment and think about the past week. Something or someone may have upset you. Someone may have disappointed you. Someone may have insulted you. And we're going to take another moment to forgive that person or those people. So focus on that for a moment and then allow yourself again to say, Salah, I forgive. I forgive. And shift again your focus to what's good in your life and what's true in your life and what works in your life. And allow yourself to feel blessed. Allow an overwhelming feeling of being blessed to overcome. Ay, 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 ay. Something else that we're really big on is jokes. So we love jokes. Normally we make fun of ourselves, because if you made fun of the Tsar, they would shoot you. If you made fun of the Emperor of Rome, they would crucify you. If you made fun of Assad in Syria this week, they would probably gas you. So it wasn't, there wasn't a lot of payoff in making fun of people in great power, but the Jews did it, sometimes in secret ways. But mostly we make fun of ourselves, because we can get away with it. No one's gonna kill us for that. So there's a strong connection in the last 30, 40, 50 years, American Jews and Buddhism. There's been a lot of mixing, there's a lot of Jew-Boos, as they call them, and so forth. So this is a joke about that. An elderly Jewish woman sets out from her home in Brooklyn for India. She travels by foot over hilltops and mountains. She crosses valleys and streams. And finally, she arrives in a small rural village alongside a steep mountainside. At the top of the mountain is an ashram housing a great spiritual leader, the guru Baba Ganesh. It takes all the woman's determination and many long hours to reach the top of the mountain. There she announces that she has come to see the guru himself. "Oh, but that's impossible," says the guru's assistant. "Nobody is allowed to see the great guru for the next 6 months." "But I must see him," the old woman cries, and she sits at the doorstep of the ashram without food or water for 3 entire days. The keeper of the gate is desperate and finally makes her an offer. "Okay," he says, "you can go in to see our leader, but you must promise to say no more than 3 words. The woman promises, and the man leads her down a long marble walkway. Tapestries and flowing fabrics cover the walls. They turn into a room at the end of the hall and enter through the archway. A young man is sitting on a bamboo mat in a yoga position chanting, "Om, Chanti, Om." The woman steps in front of him and pleads, "Come home, Sheldon." Come home, Sheldon. That's Georgiane's favorite joke, a friend of mine. So we have the joke piece and the music piece and the forgiveness piece and the gratitude piece. So I want to also read for you a beautiful translation of Psalm 100. You have 100 in your Bible, I imagine, yeah. So I know there's at least one Baha'i here, right? And there's a few Jews that I know from my community. But mostly it's Christians, and mostly I imagine it's Protestant Christians. Am I right about that? Okay. So if you're not a Baha'i, and you're not a Jew, and you're not a Protestant Christian, let me know who, raise your hand, let me know who you are, if you're willing to. What, yes? Catholics. Blessings. I'm glad you're here. And?
Unitarian.
So this is a wonderful mix. This is terrific. So everybody's got Psalm 100 in their Psalmster in their book, but you don't have this translation. This is from Zalman Shechter Shlomi. Zalman is a genius who just died recently. And Zalman grew up in Poland, and he grew up in parts of Russia, and he grew up in France, and he came to America. Right, he was very, very lucky. He got out just before the Holocaust. He escaped, basically, the last train out of Paris, kind of. He got to Spain, and then he came across to America. But Zalman knew, and most translations that you read are either that they don't know Hebrew very well, or they don't know English very well. You need someone who really knows English and really knows Hebrew, and there's not a lot of that out there, although more and more. And Zalman, of course, knew Russian, and he knew Yiddish, and he knew Polish, and he knew Aramaic, and he knew Amharic, and he also knows English. And sadly, he just passed away. I got to spend some time with him. I was very blessed. So this is his version of Psalm 100. And pay close attention. This is how you sing to God a thank you song. You join the symphony of the whole earth in your gratefulness. You meet him. Voices echo joy in God's halls. In giving thanks, we engage her blessings. We meet his goodness here and now, her encouragement from generation to generation. You are filled with joy serving God's purpose. You sound your own song as you do it, certain that God is being. We know that we are brought forth from her, both God's companions and his flock. Enter into God's presence singing your own song in grateful appreciation. Thank you, God. You are all blessing. In this world, you are goodness. Yes, grace itself. Grace in the Jewish text. You are grace itself. This is the trust we bequeath the next generation. So I wanted you to get an insight into, this is from the renewal movement of Judaism, a very modern movement within Judaism. It acknowledges the divine feminine, number one, uses the very Christian word grace, right, within the Jewish text. So I just thought you'd appreciate that, because I think it's very, very special. So that's from Solomon, so now you know a little bit about that as well. So the first thing we're going to start off with today are some images about who are the Jews. So let's see if we have some images about who are the Jews. We're going to throw some images up on the screen, and these are from my class that I teach, which I hope to teach in October at the Father Randolph's church, the Holy Communion. That's Evangelical Catholic. I love that too. So the first image, Jim, is coming up. So these are some nice Jewish people. They look Jewish to you. Is that like your standard Jewish look, right? So this is a Yemenite bride and groom on their wedding day. And there was a Jewish community in Yemen for, 1700 years, something, since the destruction of the Second Temple. Close to 2,000 years, there were Jews in Yemen. Are there any Jews in Yemen today? No. Almost all the Jews in the entire Muslim world have been expelled or left on their own for safety reasons. So this is, I had a very good friend, the Yemenite, whose name was Eli Yosef. Yosef, unfortunately, died in the 73 war, and I named my daughter after him. But the most beautiful brown skin and the most brilliant white teeth. I mean, he was a gorgeous, gorgeous man. So this is a Yemenite couple. Jewish, yeah, the next one. And these are two young boys from Azerbaijan. Two young Jewish boys from Azerbaijan. The reason you don't hear about Jews in the Muslim world anymore is because there aren't any. After about 1956, the Jews of Iraq, the Jews of Iran, the Jews of Saudi Arabia, there were never many Jews in Saudi Arabia, but the Jews of Egypt, Tunisia, Morocco, Algeria, the Jews of Syria, the Jews of Lebanon, all basically were harassed to the point where they moved to Israel, or France, or America too. So this is some Azerbaijani boys. What's the next one? I'm not even sure. So this looks like a nice Jewish guy, right? So this is a Jew in Israel from the Jews of Ethiopia. The Jews of Ethiopia, they trace their lineage to King Solomon, right? They go all the way back to King Solomon and the Queen of
Sheba.
Exactly. So in the last 10, 15 years, several hundred thousand Jews of Ethiopian descent have made Aliyah. They've been basically brought to safety to Israel. It's the only time, and I will say this, it's the only time in the history of the world that I know of that white people brought black people out of Africa to freedom. Think about that for a minute. Okay, so the next one. Who's this? Nice Jewish girl?
Lisa
Kudrow. Exactly, this is Lisa Kudrow, nice Jewish girl. Yeah? So the next one. Who's this guy on the left? You know who he is? Dimitri Salida? Pretty good welterweight. Not great. Okay, he's not a world champion. He's ranked third, fourth in the world at one point a few years ago. He's a welterweight. He weighs 147 pounds. He's from the Ukraine. Yeah. And boxing has been actually, In the 20s and 30s and early 40s, there were quite a few Jewish boxing champions. You probably don't know about them. Benny Leonard, for example, the greatest lightweight of all time, champion of the world from 1917 to 1925. So there's Jews in the boxing world as well, which you probably didn't. Did anybody know about that?
No.
Raise your hand if you knew about that. You didn't know. Somebody knew. Because you took my class last time. Hi, Jerry. So, okay. So this is Demetrius Oliva. You know, there's not a lot of Jews in the fight game these days. It's a lot easier to go to medical school. But there you go. And at least he's getting a good shot in. He's got a good left hand. So the next one, Jim. This is another nice young lady from the Ethiopian community of Israel. Beautiful, nice Jewish girl. The next one. So who are these people and what are they doing there? So this is, I'll tell you where this is if you don't know. And I actually have brought my magic wand. Look at it. So you know what that is? Right there? What's that? The Dome of the
Rock,
which means this is the Temple Mount, right here. Okay? This is Harabayit, which is called the Temple Mount. Where these guys are standing and where these girls are pretending to ignore them, even though they think they're really cute. Alright? And they're reading a Hebrew newspaper, by the way, and these guys are sergeants, you see the three stripes. So you see, this is the Temple Mount, and this is where Abraham did not sacrifice Isaac. Okay? And this is called the Has Promenade. There's a special place because when you come up from Beersheba, when you come from the south, where my oldest son was born, in Beersheba, when you come up from the south, this is the very first place that you can see the Temple Mount from. And it says in the Bible, and Abraham and he lifted his eyes and he saw the place from afar. And this is where he was standing. Because this is the first place that you can see the Temple Mount from when you're coming from the south. And the Temple Mount is where Abraham did not sacrifice Isaac. So that's this is a very interesting photograph. And these are also, these four Ethiopians, as it turns out, in Israel. And, you know, it's not an unusual sight. You get on a bus, there's 30 people. There's five people that are from Ethiopia or something. So it's a nice, significant part of the population these days. So the next image. Now here's some people praying, right? Are these Jews, you think? What do you think? They look Jewish to you, look Jewish to me. It's a talis, he's got a talit on, he's got a yarmulke, he's got a little head thing on, right? Kind of like I do right now. So they must be Jewish, except they're Baptist, is the only problem. And they're trying on Jewish garments. They're like practicing, like they're trying these garments on. So this is a picture of actually not, he's got a beard, but he's not Jewish. Okay, well he's not, so what are you going to do? So the next image. Who's this guy?
Yes.
Sammy Davis. Is Sammy Davis Jewish?
Yes.
Yeah. How did he become Jewish? Was his mother Jewish? No. He converted to be Jewish. So if he's Jewish, well, he's got the rings, doesn't he? Wow. 1, 2, 3. I think he has more rings than fingers. So how does he become Jewish? Right? He converted to be Jewish, right? So he changed his faith. And is that valid? I mean, is that the same as someone who's born Jewish? Is it like the same level, lower level, higher level? What do you think? Same. Pretty much same. Actually, in some ways higher, because he chose. Right? I was born, I had nothing to do with it. Right? He chose. So in some ways, the convert is considered a higher level, actually, in some ways. So we're honored to have him in our community. So who else? What's the next one? We have another one? Who's this guy?
German soldier,
exactly. Or at least it's a picture of someone in a German uniform. This man's name is Werner Goldstein. His father was Jewish, his mother was not. And he was the poster boy for the Wehrmacht. He was the poster child for the German army. I don't know if they let him live after they took the picture, because having a Jewish father was a death sentence in Nazi Germany. But this is a picture of Werner Goldstein, just so you know. So can you tell a Jew by looking? Not exactly. So the next image, please. There's a young woman. Do you think she's Jewish?
Yes.
You don't know? Who wants to say yes? Do I get any yeses? Not one person?
One.
One. Jim's voting yes. Okay, thanks. The balcony doesn't vote, Jim.
I knew that.
Any votes for yes? No. Any votes for no? Who says no? Judy says no, okay. Most of you are not voting. Why not?
It's a trick question.
We don't know. I'll tell you the truth about her, I don't know either. I took this picture, I put this in my thing about 10 years ago with my slideshow. I forgot. I don't know if she is really. And does it matter? You know, I don't know. Could she be? Sure. Could she not be? Sure. Can you tell by looking? No, you cannot. You cannot. Sometimes you can tell by listening, but that's another story. Okay. So let's see. We have another image, I think. So what do you think of these folks? Now, he's got the yarmulke. Okay. They got the sacramental line. Okay. She's got a head covering. He's got a yarmulke. What do you think? Is this a Jewish thing? Yes. Yes. Yes? Okay. It is. There's actually a black Jewish community of Jews in Chicago. And this is a picture from that. There were not many, but there were some Jewish slaveholders in the South. Not a lot, but there were a few. And just like slaves that were held by Christian white folks became Christians in the end, some of the slaves that were held by Jewish landholders in the South became Jews. I went to school with a young man he was like seventh generation Jewish, and he came from slaves. And so this is some of the people I think in that community came from that tradition, and then other people converted in, and other people, and so forth and so on. So you have a wonderful mix. And now there's actually a tribe in Africa, believe it or not, called the Abayudaya tribe, that has adopted Judaism and has been accepted as Jews. And they're in, I believe, Uganda. Very interesting tribe. I tried to get my son to go there to visit them. And he would enjoy. They do beautiful music, and but they have like one guitar with three strings, you know. So I wanted him to take like 10 dozen guitar strings. He didn't want to go. So this is this picture. Let's see the next one. So this is just, you know, white and tan and brown and everything in between. And so Jews come in all shapes and sizes and manners of disguises, right? There's thin Jews and fat Jews and smart Jews and stupid Jews and rich Jews and poor Jews and light Jews and dark Jews, it's all kinds of Jews, right? So that's kind of this is who we are. We're all kind of. And in America, you don't always meet Jews that look different necessarily, because 90%, 85% of the Jews you meet in America come from Ashkenazi tradition, from Eastern European Jewish tradition, from Poland, from Russia, from Hungary, from Czechoslovakia, maybe from France, but not really from other parts of the world. But if you go to Israel, it's an entirely different situation. So just so you know. So that's the first thing, who the Jews are. So was that helpful?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Great. So let's talk about the next slide, which is where the Jews come from. Where did the Jews come from? This is the journey of Abraham. It starts in Ur, which is southeastern Iraq today. It wasn't southeastern Iraq when he was there. Okay. So, and he follows the Euphrates. Now, why would he follow the Euphrates? Why doesn't he just go like this to Canaan? Isn't that a lot shorter?
Sheep.
Needs water.
Water, because this is a desert. You got it. So he follows the Euphrates up to Haran. He stays there for a while. He comes down to Aleppo, which you know is a scene of massacre in recent days. Aleppo is a very ancient place. Aleppo, which thousands of people have been killed lately. And he comes down and he goes into Egypt, has some misadventures with the king of Egypt and so forth and so on. So this is the journey of Abraham Avinu, of Abraham, from Ur to Canaan. This was Canaan in those days. There was no Iraq, there was no Jordan, there was no Saudi Arabia, there was no Syria, there was no Turkey, there was no Iran, there was no nothing. Okay, there was Canaan over here. And, you know, most of these lines, and I want to point this out just briefly, But most of these long, yeah, Syrian cultural walking trail, not a good idea these days. You want to go for a hike somewhere, go to the Badlands. You don't need to go here. So this, all these lines were drawn in 1916 by Russia, France, and England, called the Sykes-Picot Treaty, and they completely disrespected and disregarded the Sunni-Shia split that's in the Muslim world. They completely disregarded the Yazidis who live over here. They completely disregarded the Kurds who should have their own homeland but don't. And so they set up all kinds of warfare and disaster for the next century when they set this up 100 years ago. It was completely poorly thought out and not understood. Or conversely, it was done with malice aforethought because they did know, and their philosophy of the colonial powers in those days was to divide and conquer, which is kind of, you know, what that could have been as well. Chayla, right there.
Where were Babylon and Assyria?
Well, Assyria's up here to the north, and Babylonia's down. Iraq is basically Babylonia.
Okay,
down. This is Babel. Assyria is more towards the north. Okay? And then, of course, Iran was Persia, which was, you know, the Persians conquered the Babylonians, right, in about 530 BC-ish. That's a whole long story. I'm not going to get into that whole thing. So, but thank you. And I want to keep the questions to the end, if we can, and I'm going to see, because I have some things that are, oh yeah, no way I'm going to be in the Torah today. I brought the Torah, but I'm not going to have time to read it. So, I want to read about the concept of boundary crossers, which I want to read the beginning of Jewish history, if you will. And I may have to skip a few things because we have a really wonderful presentation of Ezekiel in a little bit. Vayomer, so this is Genesis chapter 12. Vayomer Adonai Abraham, and God speaks to Abraham. And all of a sudden, God's speaking to Abraham. And it's not Abraham, it's Abraham. Right, it's like A-B-R-A-M, because it doesn't have the letter H in it, which gets added later. Vayomer Adonai Abraham, lech lecha, go, you will surely go. Me'aretzecha, from your land, u'mimoladetecha, from your birthplace, u'mibeit avicha, from your father's house, and ha'aretz asher ha'echa, to the land that I will show you, which is the land of Israel, it was the land of Canaan. Ve'ezcha l'goy gadol, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless, and I will make your name great. Have you heard the name Abraham before? Do you think maybe 50 or 60% of the entire 8 billion people that live on the world and the planet have heard the name Abraham? There's 1.5 billion Muslims, and there's 1.5 billion Christians. So that's 3 right there out of 8. You think they know the name Abraham? Did God make the name great? Couldn't be any greater, am I right? Right? Ve'agavah shemecha, I will make your name great, ve'yavracha, and you will be a blessing. Ve'yavracha, mevarechecha, and I will bless those that bless you. U'mekalelcha or, and those that curse you, I will discomfort those that curse you. It's not quite as strong as curse, but it's close. Ve'nevrechu v'cha, kol mishpachot ha'adamah, and all of the peoples, all the families of the earth will be blessed through you. You know, 100 years ago, there was something called polio. Polio was a major disaster for mankind. Tens of thousands of people died from it every year. And then a man named Jonas Salk invented the polio vaccine in 1947, 1948, and there's no more polio anymore. Right? So this is one example of how the Jews have blessed the world. But there's thousands, I mean, I'm just picking. So where the Jews come from, and the concept here that I want you to get is boundary crossers. This is the Euphrates. He crossed the Euphrates. He crossed this entire, and he was 75 in that story. He wasn't a kid, right? When he went to Israel, and he went to Canaan. So, and there was no Israel either. This was Canaan in those days. So when he left, he crossed this boundary, and he crossed a lot of other boundaries to get there. He crossed boundaries of time and space. And so Abraham is known as a boundary crosser. This is another fundamental Jewish concept, to cross boundaries. I'm doing that right now. I'm a rabbi in a church. I'm crossing a boundary. Sometimes we had a pastor They called us to bless us at our Passover Seder. He was crossing boundaries and we were allowing it to happen. Are you following me with that? Okay, great. So we'll look at the next slide. I think, yeah. So there's a story, there's an ancient story that the rabbis tell that this is Abraham when he was a little boy. It's kind of like the George Washington and the cherry tree story, but it's just a little bit different and it's a lot older. So this is Abraham when he was a little boy, and his father was a dealer. His father's name was Terah, and his father dealt in idols. He had a little store, and he sold idols. And one day he went out to the market. He had to do some business, and this is in Ur, and he came back, and Abraham was explaining to him that the idols started arguing with each other, and the idols started fighting with each other, and they started beating each other up, and finally the only one left standing was the biggest one with the biggest stick. And Abraham's father says, "Baby, come on, who are you kidding? These are idols, they're made out of stone. They can't do anything, they can't speak, they can't hear, they can't do anything. Why are you telling me such a stupid story?" And Abraham says, "Then why do we worship them?" And that's the beginning in our tradition of monotheism, right? So boundary crossers, number one. Number two is idol smashers. So the Jews are known as boundary crossers and idol smashers. You got that? Are you with me? So let's look at a few other idol smashers and boundary crossers you might have heard of, right? Have we heard of this? Do we know who this guy is? This is Charlton Heston, of course. But who is he pretending to be with the proto-Canaanite tablet? Exactly, Moses. Was he an idol smasher? Did he change the status quo? Was he out there tipping the sacred cows? Yes. Was he an idol smasher and a boundary crosser? He crossed the whole Sinai Desert, right? So he was an idol smasher and a boundary crosser. Let's see another one. How about this guy? You know who he is?
Yeah, he's trouble.
This is for the Catholics in the room. This is a very Catholic look of Jesus, right? So did Jesus wear anything remotely like this when he was walking the earth? No, nothing whatsoever. Right, he was a first century Judean, right? Or maybe Galilean. So he didn't look anything like this, okay? But nonetheless, I know this is a recognizable image. And so was he a boundary crosser? Was he an idol smasher? Absolutely, right? Did he tip over some sacred cows? You bet, okay? It's a very Jewish thing to do. Next one. Who's that guy?
Sigmund.
That's Sigmund, right. Was he an idol smasher? Did he tip over some sacred cows? Right? Did he smash some idols? You bet. Okay, next. Sigmund Freud. Who's this guy? He looks like Rasputin. No, that's not Einstein. Einstein's coming. No, Einstein's much better looking. Oh, please. This is Karl Marx. This is Karl Marx. I don't know how many people are no longer alive because of Karl Marx. Probably millions. I think he had some bad ideas, some dangerous ideas, some horrible ideas. Maybe some good ideas too. But did he smash some idols? You bet. Did he cross some boundaries? You bet. Okay? Tipped over some sacred cows? Yes, he did. Exactly. It's in the Jewish tradition to do that. What's the next one we have? There he is. Now this is Einstein. Now he didn't just smash some idols. He smashed atoms. Right? So we went from idol smashers, boundary crossers, to atom smashers. Right? So we made the whole almost 4,000 year connection from Abraham to Einstein. So I want to do one more concept, and then I'm gonna have to I gotta move along here because see, Gail, I wasn't exaggerating. I'm gonna run out of time. And I will stay after later if you want to look at the Torah. I will take off the dress and we can show you what she looks like inside. And maybe we'll blow the shofar at some point. So here's another Jewish concept. So what do we have so far? Forgiveness, gratitude, music, jokes, boundary crossing, idol smashing, atom smashing, right? Those kinds of things. So that's kind of who we are, what we're about from Southeast. Not bad from Southeast Iraq, huh? So Jacob's a swindler. Jacob, when he was a boy, right? He was a real wise guy, troublemaker, swindler, thief, manipulator, liar, right? In his youth, we're not proud of him. We lay it out there. We're not kidding him. But after 21 years with his uncle, he decides to come back and make peace with his brother, with Esau. And he comes back, and he's at the Yabuk River, and all of his cattle and all the bride, essentially, that he's bringing to Esau is on the other side of the Yabuk, and he's on the other side. And this is what happens. Vayivater Yaakov levadoho, v'yavek ishimo ad olat hashachar. And Jacob was left alone, and a man, or a divine being, wrestled with him, right, until the break of dawn. And the divine being saw that he could not overcome Jacob, and he struck him in the hip socket. And Jacob's hip was dislocated. From the hit that he had received. And the divine being said, now Jacob has a dislocated hip. And he's in a wrestling match with an angel or a divine being. So, but he doesn't let him go. And the angel says, the divine being says, let me go. Because the dawn has risen, the break of the dawn has broken, okay? I will not let you go unless you bless me. Whereas he stole the blessing from his brother, he's earning the blessing from the angel. And he says to him, what is your name? And Jacob says, Jacob. Your name will no longer be called Jacob. Ki in Yisrael, it will be called Israel. Ki sari ta'im Elohim v'im anashim v'tuchal. Because you wrestle with divine beings and with men, and you have overcome. He's also overcome his evil inclination, because he's gone from a very, what's the word I want? A very, flawed individual when he was young, to he matures into being quite the God. Okay? So this concept of wrestling with angels is another basic concept I want you to get, so we need to see the next image. And that's wrestling with Angel Jacob. Okay? So, there's a couple more things I want to do, which is to read to you from Steinberg real quickly. Judaism is much more complicated than a religion. If you look at it just as a religion, you're not really getting it. It's much more than a religion. It's a doctrine concerning God, the universe, and man. Whenever it says man, you say women, of course, too, because this is written in 1947. A morality for the individual and society, a regimen of rite, custom, and ceremony, which I call practice, a body of law, a sacred literature, which we share much of that with the Christian world, institutions through which the foregoing find expression, and a people, the people of Israel, and also, since 1947, a country called Israel. So you have, it's really more of a family thing than it's a family thing and a religious thing. So I wanted to point that out to you. So, I'm going to skip a few things. It says Torah and Shofar if time allows. No, time does not allow. So, there's also the concept of partnership with God. We sing a song sometimes on Friday night. Esa Einai. Esa Einai. Sit on your butt and do nothing and ask God. So it's a partnership. This is a Jewish concept. So I want to basically get to all those kind of major, like the big rocks in the jar, if you know that analogy. Get the big rocks in the jar, which those are, and then everything else is the smaller rocks in the sand, if you follow that analogy. So we're going to do something really special. Oh, I was going to read from the Ten Commandments. I can do it. Okay, we can do it. So do you want me to hear a little extra, a little something else? Okay, so this is on page 415. And I will, and there's one thing I want to read to you in particular, and I'll be shortish. It says, Anochi al Adonai, this is when the Jews come out. This happens in about, in our calendar, in about 7 weeks from, 6-7 weeks from now, Shavuot, which is Pentecost. Right, it's 50 days after Easter, it's 49 days after Passover. I want this connection there.
Yeah.
But there is and there has been for many, many centuries a sort of a slander against the Jews or against the Jewish God in a way that the Jewish God is a God of judgment, of harshness, of punishment. And the Christian God is a God of love, and a God of forgiveness, and a God of grace. Have you ever heard anything like that? Admit it. You've heard it. I'm not insulted, believe me. But I want to read to you from the Ten Commandments and go over something to give you a slightly different idea. It says here, God is a passionate God. God is a passionate God. Who accounts for the sins of the fathers, al banim, on the sons, on the children, al shileshim v'aribayim usonah, for 3 and 4 generations for those who hate me. Are you following? So that there's an account. Doesn't say there was a punishment for 3 and 4 generations. It says there's an accounting. Right? The word is okay. Okay, davonavo, thou shileshim, we are being masonai. Vose chesed la alafim. And I will do loving kindness. Chesed is loving kindness. Chesed is like a loving act that isn't necessarily merited. You don't deserve it. That's chesed. I will do loving kindness for thousands of generations. So, what's, it says 3 or 4 there's an accounting for. And what's the lowest number of thousands? Well, that's one. That's not thousands. What's the lowest number of thousands? Are we agreed? So, if it says here, I will do chesed or alafim, loving kindness for thousands of generations, and by, I'm not just making this up, I'm actually reading it from something. So, if you're doing chesed for thousands of generations, that means at least 2,000 generations. And the accounting is for, at the most, 4 generations. Right? What's the ratio of judgment to loving kindness? What is it?
2 to 1.
Is it 2 to 1?
No.
What's 4 divided by 2,000? How much?
200 to 1.
I think it's more than that. How many times does 4 go into 20?
500
times. So the God of the Torah, the God who has been maligned for thousands of years, is a God of chesed. Yes, judgment also. But the chesed, the loving kindness, outweighs the judgment at least by 500 to 1. So, there. Now, we have something really special. And we have something that hasn't been done in a long time in church. I don't know how long. But the Jews have been reading from and singing from the prophets for thousands of years. When the Jews were exiled to Babylonia in the 6th century BC, within 50 or 60 or 70 years, they developed a practice to retain their Jewishness, and it involved reading, singing from the prophets and reading from the Torah. And we know this is true from our tradition, and you know this is true from your tradition. How do you know that the Jews traditionally in a synagogue setting read from the prophet?
Jesus in the book of Luke, in the Gospel of Luke.
In the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, sentence 16, approximately. And Jesus returns to Nazareth, and they give him the book from Isaiah to read. Now, where did he go when he was in Nazareth? He went to the synagogue. Mm-hmm. Because there's a synagogue in Nazareth, and you can go to that synagogue today, because I was there a year ago. You can go to that synagogue today, where Jesus read from Isaiah. You can see it. It's called Beit Knesset Knesiah, the synagogue church. Because it was a long time ago, a synagogue. Now Nazareth is a Christian town, mostly. And by the way, Israel is the only town, it's the only country in the entire Middle East where the Christian population is growing. The only country in the entire Middle East where Christians are safe to practice their Christianity. It's not safe in Syria. It's not safe in Iraq. And on and on and on. They just blew up two churches in Cairo, in Egypt. The Copts are under attack in Egypt. So you know that this was an ancient Jewish practice, right? And we know that this was an ancient Jewish practice. And there were, until the third century, many Jewish Christians and Christian Jews. There was a lot of mixing going on. So you could have had a church situation where there was knowledge of Hebrew and people would read from the prophets on a regular basis like the Jews did. But that died out probably 1700 years ago. And it hasn't been done in probably 17th century. But today, right, Joy Victor, a friend of ours, is not a Jewish woman, she's a Christian woman. And she knows enough Hebrew to read from the prophets. And she's going to read to you from Ezekiel, chapter 37, which is the prophetic reading that's for this time of year marked in our calendar. And I don't know when the last time was that a Christian woman in a Christian church read from the Jewish prophets in Hebrew according to the ancient notes that we sing it to. I don't know when that happened, but it's going to happen here. It's going to happen at Desert Streams Church in a few days. Really excited about that. And we put together a slideshow, a PowerPoint, that goes with the with the song. Okay? And it's a song. So I'm going to read to you what it is in English that she's reading, and then she's going to read it, sing it essentially, and then we're going to show you the images. And the first part of the prophecy is a more ancient prophecy. And then we're choosing to interpret the last part of the prophetic reading as a more modern reading. And we're going to tie the Holocaust to the birth of the state of Israel. You may see that in a few minutes. The hand of Hashem. Hashem is the way to say God's name without saying it, right? Because you're not supposed to take God's name in vain. The hand of Hashem was upon me. It took me out by the Spirit of Hashem, by the Spirit of God, and set me down in the valley, which was full of bones. God led me around and around them, and behold, they were very abundant upon the surface of the valley, and behold, they were exceedingly dry. Then he said to me, Ben Adam, can these bones live? Do you know what Ben Adam is?
Son of Adam.
Ben Adam is son of man. Yes, son of Adam, yeah, but son of man. Son of man is a big deal in the Christian world, right? Because the Jewish kings, the living kings, were known as son of God, right? They were anointed and adopted by God in a certain way. King Saul, King David, King Solomon, King Hezekiah, whoever. But the Son of Man concept is a divine being. Right? It comes out of Daniel 7. Ben-Adam. That's a whole other lecture series. Never mind. Ben-Adam, can these bones live? So God is speaking to Ezekiel almost as if Ezekiel is divine. And I said, my Lord, Hashem, Elohim, you know. Only you know. And God said to me, prophesy over these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the words of God. Thus says the Lord Elohim to these bones, behold, I bring spirit into you and you shall live. I shall put sinews upon you, and bring flesh upon you, and draw skin over you. Then I shall put spirit into you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am God. And I prophesied as I had been commanded, and there was a noise while I prophesied, and behold, a rattling of the bones. And they drew near one to the other, matching bone to matching bone. And then I looked, and behold, sinews and flesh had come upon the skin, and had drawn over them. But the spirit was not yet in them. And then he said to me, prophesy to the spirit, prophesy, Ben Adam, and say to the spirit, thus says my Lord Hashem Elohim, from the four directions come the spirit, ruach, in Hebrew is wind or spirit. So come the wind, come the spirit, and blow into these slain ones that they may yet live again. And I prophesied as I had been commanded, and the spirit entered them, and they lived, and they stood upon their feet, a very vast multitude. And he said to me, Ben Adam, these bones, they are the whole family of Israel. Behold, they say, our bones have dried, and our hope is lost, and we are doomed. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says my Lord Hashem Elohim, behold, I open your graves, and I raise you from your graves, O my people, and I shall bring you to the land of Israel. Then you shall know that I am God, when I open your graves, and when I raise you from the graves, O my people, that you shouldn't think it just happened, and you shouldn't think that it was just history working, and you shouldn't think that you did it yourself. Then you will know that the hand of God was in play. I shall put my spirit into you, and you shall live, and I shall set you on your soil. And it says in Hebrew, like, it says, v'hi nachti, and I will do it in a very pleasant way. But nachti is the root word for noach, which is Noah, which takes you all the way back to Genesis. So this ties Ezekiel back to Genesis, if you can follow the Hebrew. V'hi nachti etem al admatchem, v'datem ki ani adonai, v'varti v'asiti nom adonai. I shall put my spirit into you, and you shall live, and I shall set you on the soil, and you shall know that I, Hashem, have spoken and done it. The word of Hashem. It says nevum adonai, more like the promise. But this is more serious stuff. So this is Joy, if you don't know. She has Victor School of Performing Arts in town, and she's a great gift to us. I mean, as Ben, as a community. And so welcome her, and then she's going to sing from Ezekiel chapter 37. And I'm going to go upstairs to flip the images.
Hi, Tom. Yahweh Adonai, Vayotzi Eini Beruach Adonai, Vanikeini Betoch Habikah, Vehimliyah Atzmaot. Ve'eberani Aleihem Saviv, Saviv, Vehine
Some will be a little disturbing from the Holocaust, and then we come into the rebirth of the Jewish people in their ancient homeland of Israel.
Awesome. Benedicti et Pem el Admat Israel. Vinatem ki ani Adonai Befit ki et ki promptekem Ova alorti Eschem mi kivrotehem ami ami. Benetati ruchi vachem viritem vehinachti ethem al admat Chem vidatem ki ani Adonai divati vasiti ne
So we trace the ark from complete destruction and sadness to rebirth and rejuvenation and life. As Ezekiel prophesied 2,700 years ago. Thank you, Joy, so much.
You can follow the text for the images, pretty much, right? That was the idea. We tried to tie the images to the text pretty well. So, is it about 12:30 or so? I mean, not quite. We still got a few minutes. So, if there are, so we can maybe turn off the slides, the PowerPoint. That dates me when I say slides, right? But you know, Joy had a vision of Ezekiel that she shared with me. And then she made the mistake of letting me know that she knew some Hebrew. And I said, why don't you sing it? Why don't you learn it in the original? Learn how to do it. And then she said, yeah, that was 2.5 months of hard work for her to do that. You don't just get to do that. But to bring back to life the words of Ezekiel after 2,700 years in a church, to tie Christian tradition of Jesus reading from the prophets in a synagogue. And we've come full circle in a certain way. And I'm honored to be part of it. I'm amazed that it happened in our little family, right? What are the odds of that? So I'm going to open it up to questions if there are any. And I will, like I said, after, if you want to stay after, I'll be glad to show you the Torah. I just didn't have time to read it today. And maybe we'll take a shot of the shofar for you later on. Yeah.
We coming back to life of the bones. What about the return of Ezra and Nehemiah to the land and the rebuilding of the walls? Do you see that? Or only primarily prediction, prophesy of the 1947.
Sure. It's really impossible. I mean, when you look at the prophets, they're broad and they're sweeping and they're general, and you can impute and infer into them a lot of things. There's no question. We chose today to interpret Ezekiel in terms of the last 70 years of Jewish history. You can make the case that it was about Babylonia. You can make the case that it was about the Persians conquering the Babylonians and King Cyrus letting the Jews come back into Israel. You can make that case as well. But I chose today to interpret it this way. That doesn't make it the only way or the right way or the wrong way. It's just a way. Okay. And this is something that's another
I mean, oftentimes in Judaism, and especially with Hebrew texts, you can read the text more than one way. It's not something you're used to as Christians, that you can read a text two or three different ways. But every Jewish text, every Hebrew text, can be read more than three or four ways most of the time. So it's not that this is right and this is wrong. It's that this is right and this is right and this is right and this is right. There's multiple rights, right? There's multiple ways to look at things. And it's a little confusing sometimes for Christians because it's like, no, this is black and this is white. This is right and this is wrong. This is it. No, well, it's a little more complicated than that because of the intricacy of the Hebrew language and the flexibility. It's called gemishiyut. The flexibility within the Hebrew language lets you get to different places, you know, really relatively simply. So
it certainly seems much more dramatic, but that's the right word, to look at the bones and the carcasses from the Holocaust.
Yes.
Be tied into the prophecy of the belly of the dry bones.
I mean, it works. You can get there from the text. I mean, it's not a great leap to make that connection. It's a very small leap to make that connection. Whether Ezekiel had this in mind, or whether Ezekiel was prophesying over different bones, or the Jews of that had been conquered by the Assyrians, I don't know. But point is that it's not a leap in any way to get there from the text. And when you say it's more dramatic, I think it's probably because the way Joy's saying it was dramatic. So that's part of the reason you got it, because she gets it, and she feels it, and she understands the Hebrew, so she can convey that to you. And you don't get that from just the English, right? Yeah. You want to lift the microphone, because everyone else can hear you. They lived there a long time. You know, the Muslims conquered the Holy Land, as 630. And they've been there for 14 centuries. Now, the Jews were there longer. The Jews were there, you know, 3,800 years, if you count from Abraham. But you can't say 1,400 years is insignificant. I mean, they have some rights in the land. It's very unfortunate that Christianity for many, many centuries had a lot of anti-Semitism within it. Part of it comes from the, as I call it, the New Testament. But it also comes, in the Quran, there's quite a bit of it as well. There's nothing anti-Christian in the Torah or the prophets or the in our writings because it predates Christianity. And there's nothing anti-Islam in our writings because it predates Islam by 2,000 years or more. If it had been coexistent, there probably would be stuff in our writings that was against. But there isn't because we're older. And that's why. And there is a lot of Holocaust denial, like you say. And I'll tell you, General Eisenhower was a brilliant guy, other than being the Allied, you know, the Allied commander. He knew when they uncovered the camps, when they got to Birkenau, when they got to Auschwitz, when they got to the different camps in Poland, most of them were in Poland, not in Germany proper, they put them in Poland. He knew that one day people would deny it. So he had every photographer in the U.S. Army that he could get a hold of go to those camps right when they were liberated and took as many pictures as they could to prove that this is what happened and that it really was as bad as they said. So, you know, it's a sad thing that there is that kind of denial. And in fact, Mein Kampf, you know, which was Hitler's playbook, is a bestseller in the Muslim world. Yeah. You had a couple of microphones? You go over here.
When you did a translation, or there was a translation of Psalm 100, the scholar translated used the word grace, which is more often associated with Christianity. And I'm wondering whether the word of origin is very similar to the word you translated as loving kindness when you were.
Not exactly. Grace is chen, and chesed is loving kindness. They're a little bit different. They start with the same letter, but.
I just meant they seem to be offering a gift that wasn't necessarily.
The ultimate loving kindness, the example of loving kindness, is how you treat a body, a dead body. That it's called chesed cholemet, the true loving kindness, because that person that you're washing and saying blessings over, and you're preparing for burial, that person cannot pay you back, ever. There's no chance of that. So that's really the ultimate chesed in a way, is how you treat a dead person. That's chesed. There's a question.
What is the difference between Hebrew and Hebrew and Yiddish?
Oh, so Yiddish is Middeutsch. You know, Yiddish is basically 10th century German, written in Hebrew letters. And why did they speak German in Poland and in Czechoslovakia and Hungary and in the Ukraine and in Russia? You might want to know. Does anybody want to ask that question?
Yes.
Because the Crusades, which started in 1096, came through the Rhine and the Rhone River valleys and decimated the Jewish populations. Because on the way to the Holy Land, on the way to conquering Jerusalem, why should we go all the way to Jerusalem to kill infidels when we've got some living right here? So they killed as many Jews as they could get a hold of in mines and in Cologne and all along the Rhine and the Rhone River valleys on the way to Israel. Wherever they found a Jewish community, they would attack it and murder anybody they could get their hands on. So the Jews moved east. The Jews never left. Because the Crusades were a disaster for the Jewish population of Europe. They moved east to Poland, which was not under the church yet. The church doesn't come to Poland until the 1300s. So the Jews were safe there for three or four centuries. And they had another couple of pretty good centuries, and then it didn't work out so well in the end in Poland. You know, 90% of the Jews of Poland were murdered in the Holocaust. There were 3 million Jews at the the beginning in 1939, there were 3 million Jews in Poland, and at the end there were 300,000 Jews. Jerry?
Well, I think it should be pointed out that there are many Arabs.
You want the microphone?
No. There are many Arabs that are citizens of Israel.
There's actually an Israeli Supreme Court justice who's an Arab, who's a Muslim. And there are also, it's more complicated. Like I took soldier pictures of the Jews. There's Arabs and there's Arabs. And there's Circassians, you know, and there's Christian Arabs, and there's Druze Arabs, and there's Yazidi Arabs. And there's all kinds of Jews. You can't look at it. It's not monochromatic. You can't just look at it that way. But 20% of Israel is Arab. And in fact, you know, when I go to the old city of Jerusalem, I love it partly because it is Arab. And it's beautiful. And the muezzin, I don't like to hear it 5 times a day, starting at 5:30 in the morning, I admit it. But later on in the day, it's really beautiful and special, and it ties you to the place, you know? It's not dissimilar from the Jewish call to prayer, right? Which is less, it's much shorter, and it's not, I hope it's not as annoying. But, you know, there's a connection there. So those Arabs in Israel vote. They're citizens. Many of them serve in the army. All the Jews serve in the army. The Bedouins in the north serve in the army. The Bedouins in the south don't serve in the army. But guess what? The old Orthodox Jews don't serve in the army either. And they don't work, a lot of them. That's another story. I mean, you've got all kinds of factions and fractions, and you have to know, you know, you have to know the headgear. You have to know what hat they're wearing, you know, what party they belong to, and how to deal with these folks. It's immensely complicated. You think America's divided, holy cow. Israel's amazing that way. And yet it works. And part of the secret of why it works is it's because it's surrounded by genocidal enemies. It's surrounded by people that want to kill them. So the pressure of the external pressure makes them get along internally. If you've ever been in Israel where there's either been a terror attack or Israel's at war, everyone is loving each other completely. It's amazing how much they get along. How can I help you? Blah, blah, blah. But boy, when all that pressure's off, they're fighting with each other. So it's, in some ways, it's a blessing. In some bizarre, strange way. Microphone?
I went on a pilgrimage to Israel in 2013 with an Episcopal church from Palm Desert, California. Our guide, Iyad Kumri, introduced himself as an Arab Palestinian Episcopalian. And we worshiped in both the Arab language and in English at a couple of Episcopal churches. So when you talk about that diversity, it really, I mean, we were in his home in Jericho. I was in places I only know from the Bible. It's very amazing.
Yeah, it's very amazing. And you know, like I have a picture, there's a church in Jaffa that's been there since about 1873. And there's a sign about the worship services. And it's like, you know, Monday the service is in Russian, and Tuesday the service is in French. And Wednesday the services in Spanish, and Thursday the services are in Hebrew, and Friday the services are in Arabic, and Saturday there's something else. I mean, you have 7 or 8 languages, you know, in one church. It's amazing. So you find it. I took a picture of it, I have it somewhere. So last question, then we'll get to the joke, and then we'll get to
just an observation back to General Eisenhower. Another thing that he did is the citizens of the towns surrounding, next to, near the death camps.
Yes.
He had them walk through those death camps so they could see
yes.
what they either ignored, didn't believe, chose not to see,
right.
whatever. But he said, I want you to see what went on right under your noses
right.
so you will never forget.
Right. And he buried it too. And he
yes,
they dug the trenches and they buried. But you know, you had to know even just from the smell. I mean, when you burn bodies and, you know, and so forth and so on. So, on a slightly happier note, But no, General Eisenhower was quite amazing, and and it's true the U.S. could have done a lot more, and they could have done it earlier. There's a valid criticism about what was not done and what was known at the time. The State Department had a lot of anti-Semitic kinds of, they had an internal ethos or politics like that. But overall, look, you can't fault America too much. Anyway, so here's the joke. I think we did the question thing, right? So pretty much we did it, right? Can we do 4,000 years in an hour and a half? Yeah. Not too bad. 2,500 years? Okay. So this is a sweet joke. I hope you like this joke. I haven't told it in a while. And there's some Catholics in the room, so that's good. Several centuries ago, this joke is not historically correct. I'll tell you the mistakes in the room. But it works as a joke. Several centuries ago, the Pope decreed that all the Jews had to convert to Catholicism or leave Italy. Now that, believe me, that was true numerous times. In numerous countries, Jews were expelled all over. There was a huge outcry from the Jewish community. So the Pope offered them a deal. He'd have a religious debate with the leader of the Jewish community. If the Jews won, they could stay in Italy. If the Pope won, they would have to convert or leave. The Jewish people met and picked an aged and wise rabbi to represent them in the debate. However, as the rabbi spoke no Italian and the Pope spoke no Yiddish, they agreed that it would be a silent debate. On the chosen day, the Pope and the rabbi sat opposite each other. The Pope raised his hand and showed three fingers. The rabbi looked back and raised one finger. I won't say which one. Next, the Pope waved his hand around his head. The rabbi pointed to the ground where he sat. The Pope brought out a communion wafer and a chalice of wine. The rabbi pulled out an apple. With that, the Pope stood up and declared himself beaten and said the rabbi was just too clever and the Pope could not go on and the Jews could stay in Italy. Later on, the cardinals met with the Pope and asked him what had happened. Well, the Pope said, first, I held up three fingers to represent the Trinity. He responded by holding up one finger to remind me there is still only one God common to both faiths. Then I waved my fingers around my head to show him that God was all around us. And the rabbi responded by pointing to the ground to show that God was right there with us. And I pulled out the wine and the host to show that through perfect sacrifice, Jesus had atoned for our sins. But the rabbi pulled out an apple to remind me of the original sin. He bested me at every turn, and I just could not continue. Meanwhile, the Jewish community gathered to ask the rabbi how he'd won. I don't have any idea, said the rabbi. First, he told me that we had 3 days to get out of Italy. So I gave him the finger. Then he tells me that the whole country would be cleared of Jews, but I told him emphatically that we were standing right here. And then what, asked the woman? Who knows, said the rabbi. He took out his lunch, so I took out my lunch. Thank you, Joy.